In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. Brothers and sisters, welcome to this lecture evening on living with Iman in 21st century. My name is Shah Jahan Khan, and I'm going to be with you as a master of the ceremony. But first of all, just some housekeeping business. If you need any help finding the toilet, or you need anything, please contact the volunteers here. They will be more than happy to assist you. The program this evening is going to be as follows. After the guests take their seats, and a brother will recite from the Holy Quran, and there will be lecture by Imam of Dara Mosque, Brother Imam Ikram Baksh. And then there will be another lecture by Sheikh Taufik Chaudhary. After that, we'll pray Isha prayer. And then Sheikh Taufik Chaudhary will introduce the Kausar Institute and Mercy Mission. After that, Sheikh Taufik Chaudhary will give his lecture on living with Iman in 21st century, followed by question and answer. And finally, the organizing committee will thank the participants. So that's the program today. So without being too detailed, I want to just say a few things about what has been told to me about the Mercy Mission and its projects. Mercy Mission is an international organization, and it has activities in 17 different countries. It runs different different programs and projects. In terms of education, they have Kausar Institute. They offered various courses on different aspects of Islam. And they have also their own television station to propagate what they call the goodness of mankind. And they also have Zakat Foundation. They have other activities like charity and business entrepreneurship as well. So it's a multi-dimensional activities. So as you will know probably through the course of this night, more about this Mercy Mission and Kausar Institute. Our program is going to start with the recitation from the Holy Quran. And I request Brother Muhammad Peer to come forward and recite from the Holy Quran. Brother Muhammad Peer.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإنه لتذكرة للمتقين وَإِنَّا لَنَعْلَمُ أَنَّ مِنْكُمْ مُكَذِّبِينَ وَإِنَّهُ لَحَسْرَةٌ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ الشياطين فسبح باسم ربك العظيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سأل سائل سأل سائل بعذاب واقع للكافرين ليس له دافع من الله ذي المعارج تعرج الملائكة والروح إليه فاصبر صبرا جميلا صدق الله العظيم.
JazakAllah khair, Brother Muhammad Peer. When we are gathering here, just a few hours from now, the new moon of the Islamic month of Julhas will be born, and Muslims will look forward for a very great celebration of Eid al-Adha very soon, inshallah. The moon is a very special creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Muslims all over the world will also join the pilgrimage in Mecca. So we are actually gathering here in a very special time, preparing for Hajj and Eid al-Adha. Now, I want to mention one ayah from the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul, Inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alameen la sharika lahu wa bidhalika umirtu wa ana awwal al-muslimin. Sadaqallahu al-azim. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful, say, truly my prayer and my service of sacrifice, my life and my death are all for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the cherisher of the worlds. This is the message that relates to the great sacrifice made by Ibrahim alayhis salam and his son Ismail alayhis salam. And in commemoration of that sacrifice, Muslims all over the world will celebrate the event of sacrifice, inshallah. Today we have two main speakers. The first speaker is Brother Ikram Baksh, and he is Imam of Dara Mosque. Brother Ikram was born in Western Australia, and he went to the school there. And at the age of 10, he went to South Africa for his Islamic education, and currently, he is the Imam of Dara Mosque. I invite Brother Ikram Baksh to present his deliberations.
Jamaat al-Muslimin, brothers and elders, mothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. والحمد لله رب العالمين. The time preceding the time of the beloved Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a time of darkness. And mankind was in dire need of hidayah, guidance. However, here and there, there were glimpses of light. These glimpses of light were those insan or mankind that had the passion and desire to recognize the Allah. And one of the most famous stories of a youth preceding the time of the beloved Prophet of Allah, who had this eagerness, this want, and had this passion to connect with his Rabb, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the time of this darkness, was Salman al-Farsi. Ibn Abbas went to Salman al-Farsi in his old age, and he requested Salman al-Farsi to tell him his story about his life. So now Salman al-Farsi is narrating to Abdullah ibn Abbas his entry into Islam. Salman al-Farsi says that I was a young lad, a Persian young lad, in the city of Al-Asfahan in a place called Ji. And I was in the worship of a religion called Al-Majusiyya, which was people that used to worship fire. And I had this crave and desire to climb the ladder to achieve high results in the religion of Al-Majusiyya, until I reach a level of the keeper of the fire. Now this particular level, the keeper of the fire, was one of the most highest level in the religion of Al-Majusiyya. Salman Farsi says that my father loved me very dearly. My father loved me very dearly and had a lot of passion for me. One day my father had some work that he had to attend to, and for that particular reason, he could not to attain to his farm. So he had said to me that, "Oh Salman al-Farsi, I would like for you to go out of the town and to do some work for me. But Salman al-Farsi, my son, know that you are important to me. Your well-being is more important to me than my farm and my building. Therefore, protect and save yourself and come back as soon as you can." So Salman Farsi says that I went out that day, and I was a person that very rarely mingled with people. And on my way, my eyes struck on a different religion. I had passed a church, and I had saw people worshipping God in a way which I have never seen before. This struck me, and I became curious to see how these people are worshipping their Lord. So he said, I went into the church. I went into the church, and I started to have a connection with what these people were doing, until I lost focus what my father had intended and told me to do, and I stayed there right up until sunset. My father became so worried that he started sending people to look for me. I realized that the time had come late, therefore I made my way home, And to the astonishment of my father, he became shocked and worried and said to me, "O Salman, where have you been? I have given you strict instructions that you need to do what I have told you to do and come home as soon as possible. Where were you?" So Salman Farisi was a very honest and truthful and obedient son, said to his father that, "I am sorry, but on my way I had met up, or I had passed by a temple, a church, that people were worshipping in a very different manner." So Salman Farisi's father said to him that, "This religion that you saw, this religion is wrong. And the religion that we are worshipping is better than this religion. We are on the right." So Salman Farisi was a very simple boy, said to his father, "No, father, I think that this religion is better than ours." So father became shocked, became astonished. What he did not do for his son. Now he has just come back from somewhere and he is saying and he is denying the religion that their forefathers have been following. The father becomes furious and he decides to tie him in his house. So Salman Farisi says that, "I was tied in my house and I had enough leeway to only roam around in the house. On my journey to this church, I had asked the bishop of the church that, where does this religion originate from?" So the bishop of the church told him that this religion had originated from the city of Sham. So quietly, Salman al-Farisi sent a message to the people of the church that if anybody was coming from Sham, to please let him know so that he can make his way to Sham. So the people of the church had told him that a caravan has come and Salman al-Farisi escapes and he makes his way to Sham with one objective, with one maqsad, with one passion, with one desire, and that is to seek the truth. Salman al-Farisi comes into the city of Sham. And when he comes into the city of Sham, he starts to ask the people of Sham, "Who is the most learned from amongst you?" I mean, Salman al-Farisi wants to learn by the best. "Who is the most learned from amongst you?" So the people of the church said, "Go to this particular church. The bishop of that church is the most learned scholar from all of us." So Salman al-Farisi goes to the church and he addresses himself by saying that, "Oh, bishop, my name is Salman and I have come from the city of Al-Asfahan with one objective, with one passion, with one objective, and that is to come close towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you give permission for me to learn by you?" So this bishop said, "I give you permission to study by me." So Salman Farisi says that, "I stayed in the church with this bishop, but this bishop was not who people thought he was. I saw him taking money. I saw him preaching to others, taking the money from charity and keeping it for himself. And he says that I hated him, but for his knowledge I stayed by him." Salman Farisi says very shortly, this bishop passed away. And the people of the town decided to have a gathering on behalf of this bishop. So Salman Farisi said to these people that, "Who you think of this man he is not that. He is somebody else. He is a bad person." So the people of the town became angry. They became upset. "Oh, Salman, what are you saying? This is our bishop that you are talking about." So Salman Farisi says, "I will show you the proof." So Salman Farisi took the people to a place where there were 7 cups of gold and silver. The people became angry and decided to cremate his body. Salman Farisi says that after the death of this bishop, they had replaced this bishop with someone better. He says, "Wallahi, before meeting the people that prayed 5 times a day, I did not mean anyone better than him." Yani, he means the Sahaba. Before meeting the people of the Sahaba Kiram, I had never met anybody that had passion, who had education and akhlaq better than this bishop. I loved him like I never loved anyone before. So Salman al-Farsi says that he stayed with him, he learned by with him until the time that he was by his deathbed. Salman al-Farsi says that while this bishop was laying on the deathbed, he had approached his ustad, his teacher, and asked that, "O ustad, O teacher, you know the reason of me being here. I have left my town, Al-Asfahan, and I have come all the way to Ash-Sham for one reason, and that is for guidance, to seek the truth, to come closer towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After your going, after your demise, who do you entrust me to go and study by? Who has the same fikr, the same desire, same passion to seek the truth?" So the bishop on his deathbed, he says to Salman al-Farsi that, "Oh my son, there are very little people, very few people that have the same passion. However, there is a person in the city of Mosul. Go there, he is a bishop that is on the straight path. Go and sit in his company." So Salman al-Farsi says that when my ustad had passed away in Ash-Sham, I made my way to Mosul, Iraq. One maqsad, one objective, not for business, not for name, not for fame, to seek guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salman Farsi enters the city of Al-Mosul, Iraq. And he goes to this bishop and he says to this bishop that, "Oh bishop, I have come all the way from Al-Asfahan to the city of Sham. From the city of Sham, I have come to you in the city of Al-Mosul with one objective, and that is to seek knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you allow me to sit in your company and to learn from you?" So the bishop said, "I give you the permission to sit by me and to learn from me." So Salman Farsi says that I sat with him and I learned by him until a time had come very shortly that he had passed away. Before he had passed away, I sat by his side and asked him the similar question that I had asked my previous ustad, that, "Oh ustad, you know my story. I have come all the way from Al-Asfahan to Ash-Sham, from Ash-Sham to Al-Mosul with one objective, and that is to come closer towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now that you are leaving, who do you entrust me to sit by and to seek guidance so that I can have this connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?" The bishop of Mosul says to him that, "Oh my son, there are very few and very little people that have the same belief, the same understanding, the same passion and desire. However, there is one person in the city of An-Nusubiyyah. Go to the city of An-Nusubiyyah. There is a bishop by the name of so and so forth, so forth. Go to him and study by him. He will guide you to the straight path." So Salman Farsi, as soon as his ustad had passed away, he made his way to An-Nusubiyyah. When he got to An-Nusubiyyah, he entered the cathedral, the church of the bishop, and he said to him that, "I have come here for one objective, and that is to come close towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have come from Al-Asfahan to Ash-Sham, from Ash-Sham to Mosul, from Al-Mosul to An-Nusubiyyah, one maqsad, one desire, one passion, and that is to seek guidance from Allah. Do you give me permission to sit by you?" So the bishop said that, "I give you permission to study by me." But very shortly, this bishop, this teacher, also passed away. And before he passed away, he had asked the similar question, that, "I have come here with this one maqsad, this one desire, this one passion, to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's closeness. Please, who will you entrust me after your demise?" So now this bishop says to his student, Salman al-Farsi, that, "Oh Salman, there are very little people. You see, my dear brothers and elders, mothers and sisters, this is a dying religion. This is a dying religion, and the coming of the beloved Prophet of Allah is inevitable." So this bishop says that go to the city of Umariya, Byzantine, Turkey. There is a bishop that is a well-known bishop who is very knowledgeable. Go to him and you study by him. So from Al-Asfahan to Asham, from Asham to Mosul, from Mosul to An-Nusubiya, from An-Nusubiya to Umariya, with one maqsad, one objective, not taking Qantas, not taking Malaysian Airlines, not taking Singapore Airlines, going in the hard, hard desert with one maqsad, and that is to find guidance with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he gets into the city of Turkey, of Umariya, not only does he study by this bishop, but he also dwells into some business. Enough business for him to accumulate some sheep, some goat, and some cow. And he said very shortly, this ustad was also on his deathbed. So I asked a similar question, that, oh ustad, who do you entrust me after your demise? Salman Farsi says that the bishop said that after me there is nobody left that has the same guidance. There is nobody left. However, it is about time that a prophet is to come, and this prophet will be on the path of haqq, of truth. This prophet will have signs that is very clear and apparent. These signs are, he will take refuge in a place, number one. He will take refuge in a place where there will be excessive or abundant date palms. And it will be surrounded by two rocky plains, volcanic rock. Number two, he will accept hadiyya, a gift, but he will not accept sadaqah. Number three, he will have a protruding piece of flesh between his shoulders on his back. Khatam al-Nabuwa, the seal of Prophet. Three signs that are very apparent. He will come in the Arab Peninsula. So Salman Farsi says, as soon as my ustad had passed away, I started to look for some means on how to get to the Arab world. Somehow, just to get somewhere into the Arab world. Salman Farsi says that a group of travelers from Banu Qalb had come in to the city of Turkey. So I said to them that, oh travelers, oh the children of Kalb, I will give you all my goats, all my sheep, and all my cows with exchange that you allow me to travel with you to the Arab world. So the people, the travelers, they agreed. They allowed Salman al-Farsi to travel with them. Salman Farsi says that we reached the place of a place called Wadi al-Qura. We reached a place which was called Wadi al-Qura. When we reached this place, I thought that this was the place that was described to me. The people of Banu Kalb had deceived me and made me into a slave. So now Salman al-Farsi is stuck in the toils of slavery. Now those days, there was no sign or ID card to show who was a slave and who was not a slave. When a person was claimed to be a slave, they were stuck in slavery. One maqsad, one objective, what we won't do for our businesses, what we won't do for our families, but this young lad, this youth, only one objective he has, and that is to seek the closest of Allah. Salman Farsi says that I was sold to a Jew man, to a Jewish man. And this Jewish man sold me to a cousin of his from Banu Qurayza. From Banu Qurayza. This Jewish man from Banu Qurayza took me to a place which was called Medina. He says, when I saw Medina, I was 100% sure that this was the place that was described to me. Salman Farsi said that I never knew that the Prophet of Allah was alive and he was already preaching the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salman Farsi says that because I was busy with the toils of slavery, I did not know that the beloved Prophet of Allah was in existence. But he said one day I was sitting on top of a date palm. One day, I was sitting on top of a date palm, and my master was sitting under the date palm. And a cousin of his came to him in a very angry mood. And he said, curse the people from the Aus and the Khazraj. Curse these people. Curse these people because these people in Kufa, they have accepted Islam. They have accepted the religion of a man to claim prophethood. A man by the name of Muhammad. Salman Farsi said, shivers ran down my spine. Shivers ran down my spine. I almost fell off the tree and landed on my master. Salman al-Farsi, he's been waiting for this day his entire life. So Salman al-Farsi says, I ran down the tree. Salman al-Farsi says, I ran down the tree. And I held my master's cousin by his shirt, not thinking what I'm doing. And as I held him to ask him a question, my master took me and he punched me in my face. Salman al-Farsi says, can someone please control those children, please? Salman Farsi says that my master punched me in my face. And he said, Salman Farsi, get a grip of yourself. So Salman Farsi said that that night, I prepared myself to go visit the beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when I entered upon the beloved Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I said to him, O Muhammad, I have heard that your companions and yourself are in need of this sadaqah. I would like to give you this sadaqah. So Salman Farsi says that I observed the Prophet of Allah to see what he is going to do with this sadaqah that I had given him. He took the sadaqah, the charity, and he started to equally distribute it amongst the Sahaba. And he did not partake of this sadaqah. Sign number one. He does not accept sadaqah. Salman Farsi said, a few days later, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came into the city of Medina and was attending. As he came in, I came up to him and I said, oh Prophet of Allah, oh Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I would like to give you this gift, this hadiah. You did not accept my sadaqah, but I would like to give you this gift. Salman Farsi said that Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam got off his camel and he started to share this and distribute it amongst the Sahaba, and he also partook of this meal. So he accepted charity, he did not accept charity, but he accepted the gift. Salman Farsi said a few months later, the beloved Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was carrying a janazah. And I started to circle the beloved Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in such a way that the Prophet of Allah recognized me doing something that was very strange. So Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, oh Salman, come here. So Salman Farsi comes to the beloved Prophet of Allah. Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam takes off his shirt. And he says, oh Salman, is this what you are looking for? Salman Farsi says that I fell to the ground in tears and I started to cry like I never cried before. That Salman that traveled from Al-Asfahan to Asham, from Asham to Mosul, from Al-Mosul to Al-Nusubiya, from Al-Nusubiya to Umariya, from Umariya to Wadi Al-Qura, from Wadi Al-Qura to Medina, and now is stuck in the slavery. That one person, that one young lad, that one youth, one objective, one maqsad, one passion, and that is to find guidance. Salman Farsi says that the beloved Prophet of Allah told me to stand up. So I stood up. So when I stood up, Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, O Salman, tell the Sahaba kiram your story. O Salman, tell the Sahaba kiram your story. Salman Farsi said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. I testify that there is no deity besides Allah, and that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Salman Farsi said, I did not partake in the Battle of Badr nor in Uhud because I was still stuck in slavery. One day Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam called me and he said to me, O Salman, free yourself. So there was a particular dealing amongst the master and the slave that the slave could buy its freedom, buy his or her freedom. So Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that, O Salman, free yourself. So Salman Farsi went to his master, and he had asked his master for his freedom. The master said to him, I will free you if you plant for me 200 date palms. How much? 200 date palms. And so much amount of wealth, of money that I want. Such amount that Salman Farsi thought to himself, well, I am going to be stuck in the toils of slavery my entire life. This is something which is impossible. So Salman Farsi, with a long face, goes to Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam and says, O Prophet of Allah, my master has allowed me to buy my freedom, but what he is asking for is something which is too high. So Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, O Salman, what does your master want? So Salman Farsi says that he wants me to plant 200 date palms. 200 date palms. And a certain amount of qima of wealth that he wants. So Salman Farsi, Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, O my companions, O Sahaba kiram, help your Persian brother. Help your Persian brother. So all the Sahaba kiram, those who had 50 date palms, they came. Those who had 50 seeds, 20 seeds, 10 seed, 5 seeds, they all came. And Salman al-Farsi brought 200 seeds to the beloved Prophet of Allah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Salman, plant, put the seeds, dig the holes, but do not put the seeds in. I will come and I will put the seeds in. So when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put the seeds in, the trees grew miraculously. A few months later, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, Salman says, with a very few amount of gold and silver. And said, O Salman, take this money and give it to your master. The Prophet of Allah put it in my hand, and he said that I looked at it and thought to myself, what am I going to do with this? What am I going to do with this? So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O Salman, give this to your master, it will be sufficient. So Salman Farsi says that I went to my master and my master weighed the amount of gold and silver and it was precise exactly how much he wanted. Salman Farsi said, I was freed and I never left the side of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, the idea of the trench was given by Salman Farsi. Was given by Salman Farsi. Just by the way, was this trench made around Medina or one side? One side. Only one side was dug because two sides were the rocky plains, the rocky volcanic rock that was a natural protection for Medina. And on one side, there was excessive date palms that no horse or horses could make it through. Horses or people could make it through in a battle. So Salman Farsi, this is the story of Salman Farsi. What do we learn from it? There's many things that we can learn. Number one, desire. There's a saying that the West has. I'll give you an example. As you are driving your car, there's a billboard. You know what a billboard is? A sign. What does the sign say? What does the sign say? The sign says, just do it. Just do it. Don't worry, just do it. Don't think, just do it. Drugs, just do it. Alcohol, just do it. Don't think, just do it. It starts to create da'wah in our children's mind. That same passion Salman al-Farsi had, that he just wanted to come close towards Allah, nothing came in his way. Whether it be distance, today's time to take a flight is very cheap. From here to Japan, sometimes it goes to $100. Sometimes to Malaysia, $400 plus 5 days accommodation. We all know that. To go for Hajj, very easy. To go to South Africa, very easy. To go to India, very easy. Bangladesh, very easy. A means of education, very easy. Centrelink, easy. Those days it was very difficult. Those days were very difficult, but the passion and desire, just do it. That did not stop him, Salman al-Farsi, from seeking guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one, listen, number one. If we have that eagerness and that desire for something, nothing gets in our way. We tell a man that you earn $38,000 a year and you are taking a mortgage of $400,000. Doing the math, it's going to take you a lifetime with the interest rate for you to pay off that house. Does that stop him? Doesn't. It doesn't stop him in the least, and he ends up proving that person wrong. He pays off that house. Why? Because he has a desire and passion to do it. In order for us to come close towards Allah, number one, we need to have that passion. That same passion that we have for our wealth and for our family and for everything else in this makhluk, in this creation, we need to come back towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one. Number two, Salman Farsi says that the first bishop in Sham, he was a very arrogant and very bad person. But did that stop Salman Farsi from sitting by him? Today's time we are the breakers and not makers. Today's time we look at something and we break it. Someone starts a madrasa, break it, talk bad about it. Someone starts a Muslim school, break it, take it down. Someone opens a madrasa, someone opens up a daycare center, break it down. Someone gives a speech, look at something wrong in his speech, break that down too. I am better than you, I am better than you. When we shake hands, today's time, Assalamu alaikum. How are you, man? You good? Same pants you're wearing? Oh, yeah, same shirt, got the same car you're driving too. Oh, okay, how's your mommy? I heard your mom's sick. Where's the positive? What positive has he said? Hey, Khirir, you look that? TK? Oh, man, it's so good. Oh, you're looking good. Same pants you're wearing here? Same scarf. Why are you wearing scarf? Did he say anything good besides hello? Remember the first madrasa, the first teacher, the parents. The first teacher are the parents. When we have this negative approach towards deen, definitely our children will have the same results. So we need to have that passion first. We should stop looking at the faults of people. And we should take what is good and leave what is bad. What is good, derive benefit. What is bad, leave it, husnul dhan, think good of that person. Once I was sitting in my office in Bald Hills, and the parent came in very distressed and said, Sheikh, Imam, I'm very worried. So I said, what's wrong? He said to me that my son came home last night and he said he wants to become an Imam. Is there any taweez, dua I can make? He wants to become an Imam. Subhanallah, what is wrong with becoming an Imam? No, I just want him to know the Quran, read the Quran, don't worry about Imamat. If this is the negativity of the parents, how can the children learn? If this is the negativity of you and I, however will the children prosper in their deen? I don't want my children to be pious. My son, you can do what you want, don't be pious. Don't have to pray all your salah. It's okay. Don't worry about it. Good marks, A's, B's, no worries. Imam, I've got a problem. Can you please come? No problem. Rush to the mosque. Bang, in the masjid. What's wrong? Tell me what's wrong. I need a taweez. For what? I need to make dua. I need you to talk to my daughter. For what? She wants to get married. What's wrong getting married? No. You told me last year she was dating somebody? Yeah, that's okay. They were just talking. They were in their room alone, talking. That's fine. They were in their room alone, talking. That's fine. But now she wants to get married. If this is our attitude going contrary towards deen, what do we expect from our children? Lesson number two. Look at the good in people and not the bad. Lesson number three. We have, alhamdulillah, reverts coming into Islam on a weekly and a monthly basis. Well, what happens? I'll tell you. Someone comes to the mosque, they call the imam, someone has converted to Islam. Alhamdulillah, we're so happy. We make it on Jummah day. So this revert comes into the mosque on Jummah day, the mosque is full, he's looking around. He sits in the front, the imam says, Ashhadu, he says, Ashhadu, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, testify, he finishes, everyone says, Takbir, Allahu Akbar, Takbir, Allahu Akbar, Takbir, Allahu Akbar, give him one hug, and they never see him again. He looks left, he looks right, everybody is gone. 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 He is left alone. Deen, we want deen, that's where deen is supposed to start. Look at what Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam told his companions. Oh my companions, help your Persian brother. Oh my companions, help your Persian brother. Not are you from Fiji? Fiji say, Acha, alhamdulillah. There we help now. Aussie? No. Someone wants to marry our daughters? Where is he from? Where is he from? Has he got a rich family? Is he Khan? Huh? Dadabai? What is his surname? If he has a good education but he has bad akhlaq, no worries, education will help. Is this what our Prophet taught us? Huh? Is this what our Prophet taught us, my dear brothers and elders? Only until we as our teachers, as teachers, when we start to portray, not by speech, but by action, to our children, the ways of Islam, only and until that day will the children start to find that path. Only and until that day, when we want to change our lives and we want better for our children, that is the day that our children will tread that path. I've been working in the Society of Brisbane for 3 years. I started the madrasa on the north side from basic scratch, nothing. I've been working from the bottom up. And wallah, it's so beautiful to see the desire that the children have. A child once came to me and said to me, Imam, what is the punishment of drinking? What is the punishment of drinking? Not thinking about what this child is trying to get at. I said to this child that there is punishment and in the hereafter, fire and so forth and so forth. The bigger child, the bigger sister came to me the next day and said, Imam, she cried the entire night. I said, why? She says, because my father is drinking and learning about Islam, I do not want to see my father burning. These are children that are not in the age of baligh yet. But the model, the role model of a parent is very strong, that the child changes after a while. Us as adults, we like to say, you know, the youngsters today's time, they're so pathetic. They have no guidance. Look in the mirror and make that statement. We are fighting in Australia. We are backbiting. We are talking, we're putting each other down. As soon as a person takes a corner, then we're putting each other down. We have other hidden agendas in what we do. We want to impress others, but we need to first impress ourselves. I will end off with this. JazakAllah for coming and trying to get me off the mic. I will end off with this. There are two types of happiness. Listen very carefully. One happiness is called inbox, and the other happiness is called outbox. Outbox is a happiness that is a condition, a place, an object, a person. I am going to be happy when I get married. I am going to be happy when I buy a new car. I am going to be happy when I have children. I am going to be happy when I get a new business. I am going to be happy when I finish my studies. I am going to be happy when my children have children. I am going to be happy when my children get married. I am going to be happy. Everything, the happiness of that individual relies upon something which is outside from himself. This here is not true happiness. This is justification. And in life, these makhluk, this creation at times are going to let you down. So this happiness is a ghurur, a deception. But the true happiness is a happiness which is found in the inbox. A happiness that is not guided by an object on the outside. A happiness which a person finds within himself. Whatever condition he finds himself in, he's happy. It can be the worst of days, but he's breathing, alhamdulillah, I'm happy. Something dramatic can happen in his life, but he's happy. The worst scenario can happen, but he has the strength to fight on. He has the courage and that want and that passion. This happiness, when he becomes happy also with the outbox, it is only but a bonus. It is only but a bonus. This is the happiness, my dear brothers, that every single one of us need to strive towards. And how do we achieve this? Through iman. There is no other way that we can derive such happiness within our inbox, but only but to have connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us guidance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite our hearts. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us success in this life and the life hereafter. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين